And so good afternoon. Welcome to this Brennan Center for Justice program at the NYU Law School. We urge you to follow us on Facebook, to check out our videos and other resources online and on the multimedia section of our website at brennancenter.org. I'm Tomas Lopez, counsel in the Brennan Center's Democracy Program, focusing on voting rights and elections. We're here today to discuss the challenges posed to the Latino leadership nationwide in the Trump era. From the very beginning of the last presidential campaign to the most recent news literally from this morning, the president has consistently directed his attention and ire toward the Latino community. That includes his attacks on Judge Curiel last summer, his claims that 3 to 5 million citizens voted in the most recent election, his pardon of Sheriff Joe Arpaio, and of course, the recent news on DACA, which continues to unfold as we meet here right now. These and other actions have incited and reinforced hostility, xenophobia, and even outright racism. And it seems to keep piling up, despite the consistent and continued growth of our nation's Latino population. So, to mark the beginning of National Hispanic Heritage Month, this panel of experts is here to ask why this administration has been able to target the Latino community and what, if anything, can be done to push back. And so please welcome, please join joining us right now, starting at the far end, left to right, Roberto Frugone, the Northeast Director of the NALEO Educational Fund, Robert T. Maldonado, the immediate past president of the Hispanic National Bar Association, Antonio Reynoso, who is a member of the New York City Council representing the 34th District, which represents Williamsburg, Bushwick, Greenpoint, and I believe Ridgewood and Queens as well. Myrna Pérez, the director of our Voting Rights and Elections Project at the Brennan Center. And finally, Angelo Falcón, the president of the National Institute for Latino Policy. He's going to be our moderator this afternoon, and he was the inspiration for this program. His writing has been thought-provoking, it has been challenging, it has been provocative, and he poses important questions for not just the panelists to consider, but all of us. And so, if you want to learn more about his work, you can check out the National Institute of Latino Policy. We also have some of his writing here with us today. I urge you to take a look. And why don't you get us started?
Yeah, well, thanks for having me. Can everybody hear me okay? Yeah? Okay. Well, then you're going to regret that. No. The I was here in this room about 30 years ago, and I was basically debating the Hispanic advisor to Mayor Ed Koch. And, you know, it was a lively discussion. I think I made the guy's wife cry and stuff. And it was very, you know, I was saying, you know, how can you work for this mayor, this disgusting Ed Koch? And it was really interesting. So anyway, 30 years later today, I'm this guy in front of you, penniless, you know, nobody, friendless. And then the guy I was criticizing, you know, his son's Lin-Manuel Miranda with a play on Broadway, and he's making a lot of money. So I don't know. I don't know what to say. Thank God I won't be around 30 years from now to see what happens to this group. Anyway, I basically published for the Institute an electronic newsletter called the NILP Report on Latino Policy and Politics. And I try to use that. It's got a national following. Mostly a lot of influentials in the Latino community across the country. And I try to use it as a vehicle to try to stimulate debate on a number of issues. And what happened was with the Trump administration coming in, I started hearing back from people that they were very unhappy with the role that the national Latino leadership has been playing in terms of resistance to Trump policies and to his administration. There were questions about how the Latino leadership at the national level was too timid. We didn't have people that really stood out. And it raised a bunch of questions in my mind in terms of, well, you know, why is that the case? What are some of the issues? So I try to write a couple of essays trying to raise mostly questions because I didn't have real clear answers or a blueprint about what to do. I figured at least start getting some sort of discussion going out there in terms of what you know, the kind of questions that were being raised. Now, some people think that By being critical of the National Latino leadership, we're saying that there's no leadership or effective leadership in the Latino community. But clearly at the local level, we see struggles, people violently, all sorts of struggles around all sorts of issues around immigration, around gentrification. So there is a leadership there. But the point I'm trying to make is that there is this level at the national level of politics that somehow the Latino community is not really effectively penetrating, and we're certainly not seeing national Latino leaders emerging at the national level. So there are a bunch of explanations for why that might be the case. One of the things you keep hearing, or I keep hearing, is that, gee, we wish that in the Latino, and I'm sick of hearing it, by the way, I wish we had a Latino Al Sharpton, you know? And I go, oh my God, I don't know about that, but anyway, but the idea is, the idea of having a more outspoken leadership, more militant leadership, and also leadership that has more kind of visibility, and also mobility, people that can kind of go around. A lot of the leaders of many of the national Latino organizations really more like managers rather than kind of civil rights leaders and agitators. So there's a certain style issue. If I told you, let me throw a couple of names out. Janet Murguia, Brent Wilkes, for example. Do you know who they are? Do you have any idea who they are? Those are the heads of two of the largest Latino organizations in the country, LULAC and the National Council La Raza, now known as Unidos US, or something like that. Anyway, so I find time after time that people just don't have an idea of who the leadership, who are the leaders in Washington and people at the national level that are representing our community, and that's a problem, because we don't have much visibility. So anyway, so I have like a series of questions I try to grapple with, and I'm hoping that actually today, you know, the people on this panel will actually answer some of these questions for me, because again, I'm still at the point of asking questions. So without any further ado, let's jump into this, and we'll start with Myrna. And by the way, I want to thank Myrna for organizing this. It was very, usually what happens is when people read my stuff, they go, oh shit, you know, I hope you drop dead. Myrna said she was actually inspired by this thing, so I really appreciate that. Well, the first question I wanted to ask is, the premise of the essay I wrote, which is titled, Will Latino Leaders Effectively Address the Trump Challenge, is that there's a need for national Latino leadership to fundamentally restructure, rethink the way they do advocacy under this Trump administration. What do you think about that premise? Is that on target? Is it off?
I'll take this first. Bienvenidos, welcome. I am Myrna Pérez, and I direct the voting work for the Brennan Center for Justice. Something needs to change, because the administration is not deterred from attacking our community. I think that is per se proof that something is failing. I'm not sure that it is a failure of leadership as opposed to a systemic structure in which there are multiple placements of power. So you have the power that happens behind closed doors, right, when people are in rooms. You have the power that happens in the streets, and you have the power that happens in the ballot box. And one of the things that I, as a voting rights lawyer, I'm very sensitive to how we as a community figure out how to translate our numbers into political influence. And that is a piece of the puzzle that we have not done yet. And I think there's a number of reasons. Part of it is that our numbers and our citizenship rates and therefore our eligibility to vote don't perfectly map out. Some of it is straight up racism and voter suppression, where places like my home state of Texas are designing policies designed to try and minimize the kind of influence we have. Some of it is a disgruntlement with politics in general, so folks are not getting inspired enough to vote with all the difficulties that happen with voting. I mean, people aren't going to take time off of work, hire a babysitter to go out and vote if they think the politicians aren't going to actually take care of them. And then part of it is we are just being assaulted on so many different levels that even if you engage in one area, there's this whole group of other areas in which we're getting attacked. And I don't know that it's a problem of leadership, but a problem more in my mind of making sure that each lane each area in which we need to be strong and which we need to have influence is appropriately supported and is effective. And that each of those lanes need to look at how it is that they're doing their business and figuring out ways that they can maximize the way that they are advocating for us.
So I don't necessarily think that the system is broken. The system is working exactly how it was made to be working, how it was made to be. That's the problem that we have. Most change in this country happens incrementally. It doesn't happen through revolutions. Those very rarely come through. And when they do, for example, the civil rights movement and other, the women's right to vote, and those revolutions happen, and we're still here today talking about nonsense when it comes to race and who we are as a country. So even those revolutions ended up just being incremental advances that got us here. So my thing when it comes to Latino leadership is that until we don't gain political significance through voting, I really feel like our voice is gonna continue to be muted. And then when it comes to the current elected officials, like myself, that are there, are present, we have to tread lightly. There's so few of us in positions of significance. How we work the politics and the ability to influence change and so forth is not easy. We have our own, within the Latino community, folks that would go after you. We have machines and political systems that would go after you. All for speaking too much, right? We know that there was one race in the city council recently in Carlos Menchaca, who has probably been the leading voice of DACA and immigration in the country when it comes to, or in the city of New York. One of the threats against him was that he wasn't working on local politics. He was focused too much on international, on national politics. So when he tries to stand up, they actually use that against him. So it's just, we have to be very careful. We got to tread a certain way until we build political influence in a significant way. And there is going to be someone that is going to finally be the R. Sharpton of the Latino voice, right? And when that person gets there, I guarantee they won't be somebody that's tied to the political system in any way, shape, or form. I like to think that Angelo Falcón is actually that already. Angelo is probably right most of the time when he's writing these articles, right? But it's very hard to side with him because everyone's so scared. And you know, self-preservation is more important than the truth sometimes. And I'll be one of the first people to say that. But I read Angelo's pieces.
He's my councilman.
Yeah, I am. Exactly, there you go. I read Angelo's piece, and it frustrates me because he's right most of the time. And we're going to talk about more things here that I'll be more than happy to address and be as honest as possible, so that you guys can actually see that Angelo is not the crazy man he perceives himself to be, but is actually, you know, shines light on a lot of the issues that we have locally and internationally and nationally. And then when it comes to the development of Latino leadership, I just want to give a shout out to NALEO, who's one of the few organizations. When I first became a council member, they invited me to a conference so I could learn how to be a good leader. Little things that I didn't think were important, they were making sure that I addressed. They want to make sure when we get into a position of influence that we actually stay there and that we show that we're good leaders. Even basic things like learning how to speak Spanish in an interview so that you reach the most amount of people, and how few of us actually knew how to do that the right way. They put us in front of a camera and they grilled us, right? And those are the type of things that they're doing in NALEO to make sure that the Latino leadership is actually good leadership. And I'm extremely grateful for the work that they do. And then to end it, to finish, is that I think it's boiling right now. I think we're gonna get to a point when the Latino leadership is gonna blow up in a positive way, and we're gonna be in more positions of significance and influence. And I'll be ready to be someone that can make Angelo proud in the work that we're doing for Latinos citywide.
Good afternoon, Robert Maldonado. So I guess I'd make two points. One is that there are a lot of great Latino leaders doing a lot of great things right now. I feel like one thing we don't have is a national civil rights organization for Latinos. And that would be, you know, that's something that's missing and something that would be great to sort of unify us nationally and send out a uniform message. I feel like we have a lot of smaller groups that are doing great work, but as far as a national group like an NAACP, we don't have something like that. The other thing I would say is that now more than ever, I think lawyers are very important. especially in challenging all the actions that are being taken against our communities in court. And so, you know, as a former Bar Association president, one thing that we need to focus on is increasing the number of Hispanic lawyers in our country. The number right now is at 4%, and it's been at 4% for many, many years, maybe for 10 years or even more. As the Hispanic population generally is growing and growing, the number of lawyers is staying stagnant. And so we need to really work on getting Hispanics into college, into law school, to become lawyers, and then to have organizations like the HMBA who are supporting them as Latino professionals and helping them succeed and become great lawyers and great elected leaders, great in government and in business, which is important as well.
Good afternoon. I'm very thankful for being able to be here today. Just on a side note, I don't know that we need another Al Sharpton in the Latino community, but I do feel that we need more Dolores Huertas in our community, right? We need more Cesar Chavez in our community. Why look outside? There's plenty of examples of people that have done it well, and maybe in different industries, but there's leadership that we can be looking at. And now, that said, I definitely agree with Myrna on one point that she said about us needing leadership and work in different areas, mainly because the question set up was, do we know this individual? Has anybody heard of the name, except my colleague in the back? Has anybody heard the name Arturo Vargas? All right, so a couple, right? Honestly, it doesn't really matter. But if you're one of 100,000 people that called our hotline last year to ask about election-related questions, that matters, right? The fact that the resources are there. Or if you're one of the 750,000 people that we reached out to make sure that you're coming out to vote, that the Latino community comes out to vote, you know, that's what matters. So maybe not so much the name of the person that's on top, but really the work that these organizations are doing. And that's why it's so important that we have a more inclusive type effort where everybody's at the table, right? The people that are outside protesting, and which is tremendously important, as well as the people that are inside the building negotiating, right? All of those are really important, and all of those play well with each other. They complement each other's work. So as we have this discussion, and I know there's some questions that Angelo posed in his essays that are pretty provocative and interesting, but my message, if anything, is more about how do we become more inclusive and supportive of each other's work, right? How do we make sure that all of the areas are covered and not just a few? And one last example that I'll give is, enough with the media just asking to interview Latinos when it comes to immigration. About we have tremendously great qualified attorneys. We have great doctors. We have people in other areas that can provide expertise, that could share their knowledge outside of one or two issues. So it's important that we start looking more broadly. We're the second largest population group in the country. Like, forget about we're a minority group or any of that. We're the second largest population group in the country. That's what matters.
Thanks. All very nice responses, but I think you guys missed the point that I was trying to make. The point I was trying to make is under Trump, the time for kind of like normal politics, which is what we basically all described, is gone. That we need to develop very different strategies, and I didn't really hear any of you really talk about that. And again, I'm talking about a limited group of people at the national level. There's a whole ensemble of organizations at the national level that are representing us. The fact that people don't know who the leaders of these groups are, I don't know, it bothers me, you know? And the fact that, you know, you have groups like the National Hispanic Leadership Agenda, which are a collection of about 48, 49 national Latino organizations. They're having a demonstration today outside of the White House. Did any of you guys know about it? Sure you didn't. That's troubling to me. The fact that the leaders, and when you turn on the TV and you see who was being interviewed in terms of Latinos, you know, more times than ever, you know, what you see is Ted Cruz and, you know, Marco Rubio. I say, what the hell are these guys being interviewed for? They don't represent us. So it's there's a problem with the normal way we've been doing the advocacy work, the way we've structured it, the way our organizations have. Today I was talking to a very, very prominent Latino businessman who wanted to make the argument that we're missing the point that all this sob story, heart stuff about immigration and the poor, that we need to really emphasize, because the Republicans respond to this, to the issue of the economic impact of the Latino community. Now, that's what they'll listen to. And that would I write some things about that? I told him, I'll write about it. It's not going to make any difference. I told him, you need to get together with the national Latino leaders and start talking a whole different way of organizing and talking about how to basically better frame the issues. So my challenge to you guys is, I disagree with all of you, so what do you think about that?
So I'll take this one first. I think there's a bit of incoherence in the critique of our responses, in part because we are in a terrible place in this country because people profit, I don't mean financially, there's a gain that people are getting, whether it be psychological, whether it be assuaging the anxiety they have about loss, whether it being able to blame people. Somebody is gaining something by bashing our community. And I don't think we are going to accomplish much till we address the anxiety that some people have over the browning of this country. And I am not sure that the way to reach people is that different than the way modern civil rights movements have always been, which is, you know, find a common message, figure out what people are concerned about, get people to know everybody one-on-one so that you realize that the person is not that different from you, amassing power, using that power and using the political capital you have in a responsible and thoughtful way that then gets you more support, and then it snowballs. And I think I'm not positive that we are going to address the fear, anxiety, irrationality, xenophobia that's happening in people's lizard brains by doing something that's radically different than what people can actually hear. I mean,
if you look at, and you've been involved in the community, so you know, like, a lot of the players in Washington and all that stuff. Do you see a group of Latino leaders and organizations sitting down to exactly develop a strategy around what you just said? Have you seen that? Can you say that?
So yes, that is happening. No, we're not standing idly by. And I think I did answer your question by telling you that.
No, you didn't.
I'm going to tell
no, you,
Angelo.
Didn't.
Angelo, the way I answered your question was saying that, yes, we need a fundamental shift and change in how we do this work, but that, no, it's not going to happen because nothing happens like through revolutions anymore. It's all incremental change. So what you want to see is something that's extremely significant and like a big turnaround and like a groundswell of change. That's not going to happen. The way we've seen work happen in this country is always incrementally. It happens very slowly. We moved to a place, Angelo, where it was crazy to think about people making $15 an hour as a minimum wage. Like 3 years ago, they thought it was crazy. And now it's actually going to happen. We went to a place where education of a child that for a three-year-old or a four-year-old was only going to benefit poor people, and that would never happen either. And now that's happening as well. A lot of the things that we're seeing here are going to start moving to the left or to where we want it to move, but it happens slowly. So while you are right, the way that we can see significant change happening would be through an amassing of Latino leadership, being a viable force. I just don't see that happening. So that we kind of have to move through this process slowly, and the system is what is making that happen, and we have no control over the system. And another thing is that those revolutions that happen with African Americans and women, for example, and making sure that they have a right to vote and are significant, are all non-deportable populations in our country. What we have now is a whole population that if they rise up, can all get sent back to, not even sent back, get sent to a country that they probably don't even know, that is not the United States of America. Legally, they have a different challenge than everyone else. We are truly talking about shadows. So the people that have to look out for them are United States-born Latinos right? And their struggle is not the same as the people that are actually going through it. A DACA recipient is gonna be the person that can speak most to those issues in a way that I wouldn't be able to, right? But they stand up and they'll get sent out. So we have to be very careful about what populations we're talking about and how much of a revolution, if it's even plausible, and two, that the change has to happen slowly. And also, to end, that we have a progressive white population that is gonna be very helpful in this movement, and at this point, seems to be the leader in addressing a lot of the issues that we're talking about. And not dismissing the fact that that has value to it as well, and that sometimes Bill de Blasio even, talking about DACA, talking about the way the NYPD treats people of color, has some value as well, and that we can't dismiss that type of leadership.
Well, let me push back a little bit. One thing is, you're basically saying that the citizen Latino population is the one that could really take the chances in advocating for, you know, non-citizens. It makes a lot of sense. But the reality is, when you look at the news, the more militant people out there challenging the system are the DACA students and immigrant activists, not the U.S. citizen Latino leadership. So I think that there's why is that the case? You know, so that's one issue I would pose to you, because it's not that clear cut. The other thing, you're such a young guy. How could you just go so conservative, man? And then from Williamsburg, coño, yeah. It's a tradition of Williamsburg, you know.
So I guess to speak to my history, Angelo, and why I am the way I am, is I came out of college ready to change the world, ready to take over, organize one day at a time. And then I found out that I live in New York City and making $28,000 a year, I would have to move to another state in order to keep doing my work. And I found out very quickly that a lot of the stuff that I was doing was selling people dreams. I was selling people dreams about a change and a story that I would never be able to deliver for them, or that they wouldn't be able to deliver for themselves, right? And social media and the way things have moved and the way people get information or misinformation handicapped us in a way that wasn't existing in the past. Before, for people to get information, you had to throw a town hall, and then you have access to those people in making sure you empower them. Right now, I say something, 2 minutes later, you read something completely different in a Facebook page that you click on, right? A lot of things have changed. So, hey, Angelo, you were supposed to turn off your phone. So I guess what I'm trying to say, and he's going to pick it up. And this is one of our greatest leaders in the Latino movement. But Angelo, I guess all I'm trying to say is that we want to, my thing is I guess there are going to be people that are more revolutionary than I am. And I love those people, and I'm always going to have their back. And I think I got to change the system from the inside out. I'm going to be a significant player in these areas where we traditionally are not. And then from that, I'm going to change the system from the inside, be extremely radical. As a person in Congress, as a senator, as a representative in the state, as a representative in the city. And then there's people on the outside that are absolutely gonna be the revolutionaries, and I'll support them that way. So don't think of me as conservative, I just have a different path to change than you do.
And the other issue, I mean, I don't think anything I'm proposing is revolutionary. I'm talking about working within the mainstream structures and processes. So there's nothing, I'm not talking, because I'm, you know, I came through the Young Lords and stuff, and when these guys talk about revolution, como si na, pero it's not that simple. Pero anyway, but thanks for that. And let me go on to the Robert or Roberto.
Well, I think the councilman, let's just say Antonio.
Call me Antonio.
is a great example, because you mentioned earlier about national organizations. I think the role of national organizations is more to do the coordinating, to do the amplifying the voice. To do trainings, to be support. But the leaders are really locally. The leaders that are making change, they're doing it in their communities, they're doing it in their municipalities, they're doing it in their states, in their state governments. That's where the change is coming from, and that's where it becomes nationally. And I'll give you a quick example. One of the areas that we work in is around citizenship, right? In New York City alone, there's a little over 600,000 lawful permanent residents, green card holders, that are eligible to become citizens. They haven't yet. Significant. Well, we advocate on the national level to USCIS regarding policies that are changed and things like that, but a lot of the information that we get from our partners locally throughout the country, right? So if someone has an issue, they bring it up, and then we're able to advocate for it. So I think it's tremendously important that there's more of a connection with the local efforts, and then that becomes national.
Well, that's I guess that's the question I'm raising. I'm not questioning the efficacy of our organizations and the stuff they're doing, you know, work NALEO on different issues, different organizations. So I'm not questioning that. What I'm questioning is, are we having the kind of impact at the national level that we should be having as a community with all the resources, with all that stuff? There's an interesting book coming out, Juan Gonzalez, calling Reclaiming Gotham. And he basically argues that Bill de Blasio and a number of other progressive mayors are the beginning of a progressive movement at the local level, you know, in terms of countering the Trump policies. But the question is, does that local level stuff translate nationally at the level? I mean, it obviously impacts nationally, but does it impact in the national debate? Now, you turn on the TV and you see the debate that's going on, and you don't really see Latino faces, Latino leaders as part of that discussion. You also don't see Latino organizations really also mounting forums. I mean, I took a group of Latino local app policy groups, this is years ago, to meet with the Heritage Foundation to find out. I told them, I don't care about your politics. I just want to know how the hell you guys do what you do. And man, I walked out of that place saying, holy shit, you know, these guys have all this money. They have like all this staff like crazy. And they put together forums and conferences that get national attention. Now, you notice in the Latino community, you don't see very much of that. So what I'm saying is that, you know, I'm not questioning what you're saying about the work of NALEO or anything like that. In fact, I think it's very good work. But how somehow it's not coming together at a level that we need it to at the national level. And that's the only thing I'm kind of concerned. And, Robert, do you want to jump in also? Because you were the head of the Hispanic National Bar Association. So you interacted with a lot of the organizations, and I'm sure.
We did, part
of strategies around.
And we did, you know, we've had national conferences.
Now, this was pre-Trump.
Yeah, it's pre-Trump. When I was president, it was pre-Trump. But I'd say, you know, we had national conferences and national panels on topics of, you know, importance to our communities. And I think, you know, we did have a lot of trouble getting traction and getting news and getting people there. Part of the problem we had as an organization is a lot of that has to do with money. And getting people, getting high-profile speakers, you often have to pay high-profile dollars. And as an organization, we didn't have that kind of money, and so we couldn't draw the speakers that would draw the press, that would draw all the attention to the issues that we were discussing in our organization. And that was a challenge for us, and I think that's one of the areas we need to address. And, you know, I saw in your list of topics about, you know, philanthropy and getting the dollars and getting the money behind our organizations and our causes so that we can be more prominent and our voices can be heard. And I think that's something we need to focus on and change.
One of the things that I think should not be lost on this is how sometimes local wins translate into national successes. So, for example, I think of the kind of influence that an organization like Maldiv has in California. And then I think about when an organization like MALDEF has the kind of influence it does over political leaders in California, those political leaders then are educated, agitated, informed advocates that are then become national players. And it may not be as direct of a link, but I think that is an important way to influence things. And I think it is not lost on me that a number of attorney generals are the ones leading the charge in terms of suing on some of the worst of the Trump administration programs. And I think those folks were moved because they had people in their states educating them and holding them accountable. And so I think we can't just assume that because something is localized that it's not having national influence. We just have to understand that as a community, our political power is still growing. It needs to keep growing. And I think it's a mistake to presume that that what we're able to do at the ballot box isn't going to sweep and dominate whoever it is that our leaders are. And if we as a community are deciding that we either are not being inspired enough to vote or that the system is being set up so hard that we either can't vote, or when we do vote, someone is trying to dismiss our vote or suppress our vote, we're never going to be able to close that loop. It's a feedback loop that is making everything worse. And I very firmly believe that if we get that one piece unlocked, and that's going to include dealing with redistricting policy, it's going to include dealing with voter suppression, it's going to include changing the way that we punish people with criminal convictions in terms of being able to vote, it's going to mean that we need automatic registration. But we need to get that ballot box piece of it so that people are scared of us, that people that know that there's political influences that stand behind our numbers.
Right, but the question is, how is it that the community gets motivated enough to turn out? And a lot of that could be also, as you mentioned, it's kind of this little loop there of inspiring. Who inspires the community to turn out if what they see is a fragmented politics, right? And they see leaders like Hiram Monserrat running for office after all the horrible things he did. So, you know, there's that issue of leadership again, the role of leadership at the national level, and how basically it inspires the community and mobilizes the community as an issue. So it's not something that just happens necessarily that people think it's the right thing to do to vote. You know, we obviously have a lot more to do in that regard, but I'm sorry.
I think part of it is messaging, really, because it's easy to perpetuate a negative story, right? I mean, that happens, it's easy, and we turn on the news and we see negative all the time. But I think it's important that we start highlighting the positive that happens, the success stories. I mean, on election day, Donald Trump was elected, and that's what this forum's about, but the Latino community also picked up a congressman in Florida, in Nevada. Here in New York City, right, the first Dominican American to go into Congress. Another story which, again, you don't hear about that much, but the fact that Kamala Harris was elected to the Senate in California opened up the Attorney General's position. The fact that the Latino community did come out in California provided pressure, we're saying, to the administration to appoint someone that's a Latino, which they did, and now making significant contributions to a lot of the issues that are happening nationally now. So I think part of it is making sure that we're sharing, that we're perpetuating the positive stories, the success stories, the progress that our community is making. Not something that we're making up, but our community is making progress. Now let's hear those stories.
Now, is something wrong with me, or am I misreading the thing, the fact that I really do see a tremendous cynicism about our leadership, our lack of visibility at the national level, and the lack of an aggressiveness on the part of the Latino community in taking things on and inspiring the community? Am I missing something? Because Roberto, what you're saying, it sounds like, you know, hey, it's a nonprofit thing, you know, we do our programming and we do some good things. I'm not challenging any of that. I'm just saying it's not bubbling up. There's something at a national level that's not happening. Yeah. And I'm wondering, how do we address that issue? What's wrong with that? So I agree with everything you're saying in terms of the positive things you're doing. So I'm not challenging any of that. But this at a certain level, there's something wrong, and I hear it from people. I mean, not only do I talk to people, we do online surveys of Latino leaders. We get a sense of that, and there's that sense that there's something wrong. There's something not working.
So I don't know, I agree with that. There is a cynicism when it comes to elected officials. And then when people see a Donald Trump get elected, they really start saying, look, this is why we shouldn't get involved. It's like no matter what we do, lo malo se meten. The Latinos that get arrested in the New York State Senate and Assembly every other year, right? It is a lot of cynicism. I agree. My mother can't stand it across the board. But I do think that there's a young crop of elected officials that weren't born into the system, right, that are looking at it slightly different. And I think our future is much brighter than our present. And in some cases, we're making significant progress. I want to say that I just think it's a time thing. It's an issue with time right now. We're seeing a lot of like the Puerto Rican leadership is getting a little older within like Congress and so forth. But there's young people in local positions that are looking to move up. And I think that there's going to be a breath of fresh air when people see young people that are not born into the system, that don't understand politics the way it was in the 1970s and 80s. That could be a positive thing. But you're right. There is a level of cynicism across the board. You know, my mother only votes for presidents and me. Outside of that, she's not invested in the movement yet, and how, and you know, she's a a mother of an elected official. So I want to see, and I use her as my litmus test in the South Side. If my mother's not doing it, then the other viejitas are not doing it in the South Side, right? So I want to see what does inspire my mother, what gets her motivated. And we're just not there yet. We really aren't.
Let me ask Myrna and Robert about, because one of the things I try to argue is I think there's a special role, and already the point was made, for our legal organizations. That right now, I think it's important to support them. It's important for them to be more aggressive and also more visionary in terms of also how they plan to address this. I think it's really significant looking at the role and what's been happening with the ACLU because of the aggressive stance they've taken. They've also raised a lot more money and have been able to expand. And one of the things that's interesting is that the head of the ACLU is Puerto Rican. The head of the MALDEF is Mexican American. The head of the Latino Justice is a Puerto Rican, and the head of Legal Momentum, which used to be the NOW Legal Defense Fund, is a Puerto Rican. It's kind of interesting, and I wonder if they even get together to kind of strategize or anything
like
that.
I promise you that they do. I promise you that they do. There is a lot of interest in making sure that the legal fights that are happening are done in a coordinated and thoughtful way. Just because we're talking doesn't mean that everybody agrees. And just because folks are talking doesn't mean that perspectives as to priority are going to be aligned. And just because folks are talking doesn't mean that we still have the same sort of resources. But I think if we don't have legal organizations that are dealing with issues that are neutral or endemic to the Latino community, we are going to be in a position where white progressive organizations are the ones speaking for us. I also think that we need to be mindful about what is happening such that all of the best and brightest law students are looking for certain organizations when there might be other spaces available where people can have an impact. And sometimes not being part of the same old guard allows room for people to grow and to try new legal theories. I mean, as a professor, I'm always trying to teach my students like history, and like people don't remember that Thurgood Marshall was super controversial back in the day because he had a legal strategy that was national. And he would go in with his resources and sometimes have real scraps, like real legal scraps with some of the lawyers on the ground that didn't have this grandiose plan about how to make our country less racist. They just wanted their kids to go to better schools. And I think those kinds of tensions are not going to go away. And we're going to have to work through some of them. But if we don't have some of these legal organizations doing some of that work, then we're never going to make sure that the issues that are important to the Latino community don't kind of get swept under the rug because of something that is higher profile or has more attention.
Yeah, and I agree with that. And they do, you know, MALDEF and Latino Justice all do great work, very important litigation on behalf of our communities. Again, one of the things I mentioned earlier is not having a sort of a national litigation organization. And so we have different organizations, and I don't know that we would all even be able to explain the difference between MALDEF and Latino Justice and the work that they do. So I think part of it also, as I mentioned earlier, is getting more of our lawyers into these organizations and doing that work. And you know that's a challenge also, getting the Latino lawyers who are graduating from law school to do that kind of work and to do the civil rights work and to do the litigation. That benefits our community.
Robert, let me follow up on a point you mentioned about the philanthropy, because one of the things I try to argue is that the Latino organizations, one of the limitations they have at the national level is that the Latino community, the population has grown tremendously, and the organizations really are most of them are very small organizations. They haven't been able to get the resources to expand, to have the resources to pull a lot of this stuff off, and that's been a problem. One of the things is we've tracked report after report by groups like the Foundation Center, Hispanics of Philanthropy, and other groups that have documented that the amount of philanthropy going into our community from foundations is minuscule. It's like 1% of philanthropic dollars. And we see these reports, and we see people decrying it, but no one does much about it. One of the problems, I think, is that the organizations go and approach philanthropy on a one-by-one basis.
Yep.
To raise money for their particular organization, and no one has really gotten together to talk about how do you hold philanthropy accountable to our community. In other words, it can't be just on a one-to-one basis, but people have to collectively, I think, approach the Ford Foundation, approach the Rockefeller Foundation. And in other words, again, the need for a different strategy that hopefully would pay off even greater, you know, in getting resources into our community. Robert, does that any of that stuff make any sense to you?
Yeah, it makes total sense, and I agree with you. We have, you know, for our organization, our nonprofit, we get very little money, if any, from philanthropical organizations. Our fundraising comes from law firms and corporations who want to support lawyers, Latino lawyers. So we have, you know, we have that challenge. And I think that the issue you raise is exactly right, is you have all these small organizations that are all doing similar work, going after the same dollars. And you know, how do you make yourself stand out, and how do you get the organizations to give to you? And I think there has to be some collective efforts and collective strategies as to how to mine that money, because there's a lot of money there. And as I mentioned earlier, that money is necessary for us to move the ball forward.
Let me just, Tomas is coming up, but I just want to say quickly, for example, one of the, you see in our community with the kind of fractionalism and different organizations kind of going in different directions, for example, there's an organization called Hispanics in Philanthropy that was established to try to get more foundation monies into the Latino community, and they were supposed to be like what they call an affinity group, a small organization to try to do this. Right now, they've done much better fundraising for themselves than for the community. So they have like a budget of like $15 million. And they're supposed to be advocating, right, for the community getting more monies. So you get this kind of dysfunctions, I think, and nobody calling people out when these kind of things happen. So it's just an interesting example. And you should go to their website. They have a beautiful website, because they got the monies they could pay for it.
As you can see, we can do this for a while. And what I want to do now is see if any of you would like to join us. We have set up a microphone at the front of the room here. If folks have questions, you can sort of line up and ask. I know one thing to sort of kick off the Q&A is folks decide if they want to be a part of it. I've been thinking a lot over the last 45 minutes about my own background, my own position as a Latino lawyer working on these issues in this era. And one of the things that I think one of the sort of subtexts of all of this is, you know, a certain degree of apathy toward leadership that exists, probably not just uniquely in the Latino community, but, you know, that I think does exist in the Latino community. And I'm curious, you know, if there are any folks kind of on this panel who have any thoughts about how, you know, for instance, Councilman Reynoso, how you might engage your own mother on, you know, this kind of stuff. I think about that. I'm a voting rights lawyer, and my parents don't vote, and I haven't figured that one out yet. And so I'm curious about, you know, how you, whether in your lives or in your jobs, think about that.
So, I really feel that. So I think elections need to change locally. I think that's a big issue. I, for example, just recently was a part of an election for myself, of course, to try to get reelected. And I send out mailers to 10,000 people that I assume are gonna, that I know are absolutely gonna vote. They're called triple prime voters. Those are people that voted in the last three primaries and three general elections that happened here in the city of New York, including the presidential, the state, and so forth. Those people are absolutely gonna vote. They get my information. I give them 9 mailers. I give them phone calls. Angelo's tired of the phone calls. Those are the people that we go after. There's 55,000 registered Democrats in my district. That means that 45,000 people didn't get one mailer from me, didn't get one phone call, got no information on whether or not this is happening. They also are not educated on the topics. They're also not educated on the work that I did, or not informed on the topics that matter, not informed on any work that I was able to do. But we know those people are gonna come out. There's the first elected official that decides that prime voters is not the way to go, that they're actually gonna reach out to all 55,000 registered Democrats to encourage them to come out. would probably be the first elected official that's informed their community the right way and would probably lose. Because they would use their resources in a very, it's almost like a gamble. They would use their resources in a broad way. The way we could get your mother engaged is that out of those 9 mailers, one of them has to be something that she cares about. Education, open space or the environment, sanitation, roads. But she won't get those because she doesn't vote. So she's never gonna be engaged. I think eventually we're gonna have to figure out a way, a system that doesn't just educate or inform the 10,000 people that always come out to vote and that probably always come out to vote because they're always the ones that are informed. And I think that would eventually be a way that we can engage those folks. But right now, there's more than 80% of my voting population is completely left out of the loop. And I'm a part of that problem. So I know it, and I'm looking to figure out a way to address it. And the way you do it is be a very popular elected official that is absolutely going to win, and then just open it up. And I think we could figure that out long term.
I mean, the other challenge you have in terms of getting people to come out and vote is that there's a certain irony, right? And you mentioned the $15 an hour, there's other progressive policies. The more people feel they're getting things like that, that's helping them, the more they start taking it for granted, and the more they feel, well, what do I gotta get involved with all this political stuff when there's a bunch of crooks or a bunch of big mouths or whatever. And most people you talk to, politics is not relevant to them, But you take the same person and you tell them, hey, the baseball game yesterday, in the third inning, what was the name of the third batter? And they'll tell you the guy's statistics and everything, same person. So I think that's a big, big challenge. And that is from the kind of progressive politics you're talking about, it creates itself a certain, kind of apathy because people do take things for granted. And I think that's where Trump helps, right? Well, Trump kind of tells people you can't take things for granted. So that's kind of interesting. But anyway, I'm sorry. Does anybody else want to jump in? Okay. Hey, remember, it can't be a stupid question.
Hopefully it's not. My name is Ariel Garcia, and I am actually from Texas. So I have a question for you, Myrna. And I think a lot of the discussion here is about getting a national platform together for Latinos, finding a way to unify our message. But one thing I did notice, at least during this election, is that the Latino platform is more diverse. The political platform is more diverse sometimes than people might actually think. And being in New York, we're kind of in our own bubble, but I know plenty of people that are Mexican American that voted for Trump. And so my question, I guess, is, what can we do either to educate people, to kind of get them to see that they are voting against their own interests, Latino community members that are doing that, and I guess whether you think that is a problem that we need to focus on in order to, I guess, have more of a unified national front.
I think it's hard to get unified anything. Because I do think that we need diversity of ideas in order to test our ideas and in order to make sure that we're moving ahead. And I also think we need a diversity of voices in order to make sure that we're forming the appropriate alliances that we need to get to the numerical numbers that we need to get. I think Texas is an interesting case because it is it's a state that where the Latinos used to be pretty reliably Republican voters that are now switching, in part because one particular party has seemed to make it very, very clear that there's not a lot of space for them there. And I think as that becomes more aligned, we're gonna start having some of the issues that that will happen in some of the other communities. So for example, we had a strict photo ID law get passed that the Brennan Center and others are challenging to try and shave off some percentages of people that were largely poor and of color because people started getting nervous that the Latino demographics were shooting through the roof. That kind of political attack would not have happened if folks thought that, those folks might be voting Democrat, they might be voting Republican, quien sabe, right? So having political influence in one way engenders problems that we also need to be able to block and tackle in another. And what I would encourage Latino voters to do is to think about like the long game and to think about what sort of policies in the end make it hard to be part of the American dream, make it hard, interrupt the kind of inclusion in the fabric of American society that most immigrants like aspire to do. And if folks aren't accepting the fact that there's some people that are just not gonna be happy because they see you as being a threat to them, that's hard to square away. I mean, like, I mean, it's very hard to talk to folks that think, you know, if a Latino family gets a kid into a great college, they're not taking a spot from somebody else. If a Latino gets a great job and becomes a doctor, that's not a white doctor, that didn't happen. And we as a country need to figure out, I think, how to make the idea of change not be so much an issue of loss, right? Nobody fears change, people fear loss, and people are fearing that they're going to lose what it is that they have and are vilifying communities for it. And that, I think, becomes like a harder national question than just a simple, like, Latinos don't vote against your interests. Like, as long as there are people that are going to be threatened by the gains that Latinos make and that it's going to take something away from them, we're not going to have a lot of movement because we'll succeed and then they'll figure out another way to get us down.
Hi, good afternoon. So my name is Stephen Hernandez. I'm from the Bronx. I am a representative at the National Hispanic Institute. They're an organization based out in Texas, and I work with them here. I work for them here in New York. I work with a group of students, high school students, on a wide scale. So my question is geared more towards what can we do for our students, and what can we do to get them to change the trend that we see now. What I heard a lot in the discussion was we don't know how to get our voters now engaged. My mother's a lot like your mother, a lot like his mother. She isn't engaged, she doesn't vote. She actually texted me the other day asking me, so what's this about Trump and DACA, what is that? And that's my mother, who is 40 years old and having no clue, asking her 21-year-old son.
But at least she can text, that's pretty cool.
At least she can text, right. how do we change that trend with our students and get them to improve their situation for the long term? Because if we're talking about long-term growth and long-term development, it really does need to be an education with our students and growing that.
Well, I would say two things, and this I tell. So I've done political consulting before working for NALEO, nonpartisan, but. Is really target the message, right? So it's not enough to just say, yeah, we want to talk to young people and then provide a message and then assume that a percentage of that message will get to young people, but really start engaging. And I think the other side of that, and I think touches not just to young people, but I think overall, there's definitely extremes on both sides, right? But at some point, we need to, especially within our community, but I think overall as well, create an environment that we can have some dialogue. It's very difficult, if possible at all, to be able to scream at someone and have them adopt what you're trying to say. I mean, it just doesn't happen. So being able to create an environment where you understand that there's legitimate concerns on the other side, and then they have an understanding that you have legitimate concerns, and you're sitting down and discussing. So I think that's really important. But yeah, as far as young people, I think the targeting and doing it very deliberately is the way to be more engaging.
So we are running very low on time, and I want to thank you guys for your questions. But for a final question, I wanted to see if Angelo, you had any final thing you wanted to ask this panel.
Let's see. I have all these questions. Just in terms of any just last kind of comments you'd like to make. Again, the argument I was making was, I guess, fairly narrow in the sense I'm talking about, Washington, the national level kind of politics, saying that there's something wrong there in the way the feedback I'm getting. Based on this discussion, does any of that stuff make any sense to you, or or where do you think we should go in terms of the kinds of questions we should be asking at that level? And why don't we start at the far end? Since you're on a roll already. You
know, yeah, I know, I talk a lot too. I'm always really excited to read your writing. It's always very provocative. And especially one of the comments that you made in your last essay was about using the example of an individual, but overall the question was, do people that work within the Trump administration or people that support, are they traitors to, or collaborate, you know, do they betray our community? And I think my message, if any, is really that we should all be engaged. People that, you know, this last election, there was a little over 27 million Latinos that were eligible to vote. A little over 14 million nationally voted. I mean, there's a lot of room to do a lot of work. There's great organizations that are doing voter registration, but we also need organizations that may not do registration, but do more outreach to people that are already registered to vote. There's space for everybody. So if anything, the most important thing is really to start engaging, to facilitate making sure that everybody has a seat at the table.
I guess my message would be that the Hispanic population is not monolithic, that we have a wide variety of viewpoints on many, many issues, not just immigration, not just voting rights. We have views on taxes, we have views on North Korea, you name it, we have lots of views on lots of issues, and we're here and we're ready to talk to you, and we'll give you names of people who can come and speak on all these issues, and you should want to hear from us and listen to us.
I would say that I do think that there is an issue when it comes to like national representation being popular enough or voicing their opinions in a way that people are gravitating towards them. I agree with that. I don't necessarily feel that there's like one voice or many or even several voices that are just speaking specifically to what the Trump is doing. But I have a lot of faith in our future. I think that Trump helped accelerate a lot of the work that I think is important for what we need to do. And again, I think it's a bright future. And I just want to make sure that as a group here, we don't lose out on the small victories or any victories, that we respect that we're making progress as a people, and that, again, the future is bright.
I think you're absolutely right that something is really wrong. I do not understand why the administration is not more afraid of us. I do not understand why the attacks keep coming. They shouldn't, because of what our numbers look like and what they will be. So something is definitely wrong. I think where I may depart from you, Angelo, is that I don't know that your prescription, I don't know that the problem is our national leadership. I think the problem is bigger than that. I think it's we have that 9 million gap that Roberto mentioned. We have people that are not showing up to vote. I think we have people that have complicated lives and economic situations and family situations that make it hard to prioritize, fighting against what the Trump administration is doing, and therefore are not going to be showing up at rallies and marching on buildings. And I think part of what we need to do is make it easier for people to hit politicians where it hurts them, which is at the ballot box. And that should be a mission for every single organization that thinks that it is their job to serve Latinos. Like, every single organization that provides services to Latinos should include a civic engagement component and should try to do their work in a way that makes it easier for people to vote if they are eligible to do so. And I think unless we turn our numbers into political power, we're still going to be the community that people like to vilify.
Well, I'm just sorry to see that none of you know what you're talking about. But yeah, hey, listen, what are you going to do? No, thank you. Thank you very much. I just want to say also if you're interested in reading some of the stuff that I've written and other people have written on some of these subjects, I left some business cards out front for the NILT network. Or you can go to our website, latinopolicy.org, and there's all sorts of stuff there. It's not a pretty website, but it's full of information. Let me just say thank all the panelists. Again, Myrna, thank you for putting this together. All of you for being so, honest and outspoken on these issues. And I also want to, I can't leave this place without saying that I also want to say that we all have to give a lot of gratitude to the Brennan Center, because I think the Brennan Center has been playing an amazing role in terms of raising all sorts of issues that affect not only our community, but the entire country and poor people. So I think I've got to give kudos to the Brennan Center. I just felt I had to say that before I left the room. Thank you.
Thanks again, everybody, for coming. And again, BrennanCenter.org if you want to learn more.